Hey guys, how the hell are you? Time for an all-new iFAQ video, number 22 in this series. And I just want to say, man, I really appreciate your guys' continued support. I really appreciate getting the opportunity every weekend to answer these questions for you. I really appreciate how you guys always tune in and check out the new review videos, check out all the cool stuff that's coming up. You know, I feel like I don't say it nearly enough, nearly as much as I should, but I really appreciate you guys. It reminds me of something that Henry Rollins once said. You know, my talent is mediocre, but my audience is stellar. And that is definitely fitting in the case here. You know, I really, really appreciate you guys, and I love you. So with that, let's go into the very first question. Love the videos. You said that George Lynch is one of your favorite guitarists. My question is, what is your favorite Dokken album that features George Lynch on guitar? Ooh boy, y'all are going to hate me for this answer. Dysfunctional. I fucking love that record so much. And the reason why I love Dysfunctional is because that is Dokken reuniting and dispensing with the bullshit and the pretense. It's just, look, we're a fucking kick-ass rock band, and we're gonna kick-ass and rock. And that's what you're gonna get with this record. There's some moments on that record that are super shreddy. There's some moments on that record that are super thrashy. Yeah, there are some moments on that record that are maybe a little bit questionably alternative, but I still love that record. It's just fucking phenomenal to me. You know, it was also, granted, it was also my first exposure to George Lynch and to Dokken, but it's one of those records that really has not been topped as far as, like, going back and listening to all the old stuff. Like, to me, the only two records that kind of hold a candle up there as far as George Lynch is playing is that first solo album he did, Sacred Groove, and that Lynch Mob album, Wicked Sensation. You know, everything besides that just, to me, doesn't stack up in terms of the tone, in terms of the playing, in terms of how much it just fucking rocks all the way through. So, I know that's a weird answer to that question, but what can you do? Hey man, love these iFAQs. What are your thoughts on guitar tabs getting taken down over intellectual property rights by labels or artists? It seems like this is mostly in the metal community that this is happening, and more are getting flagged lately. Like, I get they own the music, but I'm just trying to learn how to play a riff I like, not steal from the artist or pirate their stuff. Cheers. I've got a few opinions on this. Firstly, I actually didn't know that this was necessarily going on, but I can kind of understand why it would be going on, because a lot of times these days, a lot of labels and a lot of artists, actually not even just these days, it's kind of happened for as long as I can remember, a lot of times these artists are partnering to release official Tablature, i.e. you have to pay a price to get them. And to a certain extent, I can understand why artists would do that, because we need to be supporting these musicians as much as possible. Not just now during the COVID crisis, where they're not out there on tour, where they're not making any money from record sales or anything even, where they're having to resort to finding new ways of, like, stream revenue and that sort of stuff. But, you know, really anything that a musician can do to earn a little bit more money as a musician, I say go for it. If that means that they have to work through a record label and license stuff out, fine, whatever, but as long as musicians are making money, especially during these trying times. Now, here's my next opinion on it. Do your damnedest to learn the music by ear. If that means that maybe a chord here is a little off, or, you know, a riff here is a little funky, that's fine. But it gives you a good stepping stone, and maybe by talking with your buddies, maybe you can kind of hash out what is incorrect about it. or, you know, going on to like YouTube and checking out guitar covers and seeing how they're playing it, for example. But I am not exactly one of the biggest fans of tab. I love that it exists to a certain extent. I think it's a great stepping off point, but I think people rely a little too much on that. And I think that we kind of need to get back as a guitar community to the practice of just learning stuff by ear the way we used to back in the day. I think it's for the sake of our own development that we kind of really train our ears so that we can pick out what notes are in which chord, what rhythm pattern is being played here. Because there's definitely been a lot of times where I've even bought official tablature and it's not exactly been 100% dead on the money. Learn stuff by ear, maybe occasionally check a tab or a piece of sheet music so you can cross-reference, but try to learn stuff by ear. Hey, quick question. I have owned two ESP guitars since the late 80s and early 90s, specifically one of the original Lynch Hajib guitars and an M2 Deluxe. What is the real comparison in quality between ESP higher price and LTD series guitars? Thanks. So this is a great question. So a lot of times companies are putting out lower cost series, you know, Fender has Squire, Gibson has Epiphone, ESP has LTD, etc. And a lot of that has to do with keeping costs down by moving production to certain factories overseas, you know, maybe cheapening on materials a little bit, and sometimes cheapening in terms of build quality. In certain brands' case, I feel like the difference is a little bit more negligible than others. In terms of ESP, I definitely think that you start getting really, really, really in depth when you're looking at the differences between an LTD versus an E2 versus an actual real ESP. So real ESPs, as far as I remember, as far as I understand, are still all made in the same kind of custom shop setting. And therefore, there's a shitload of attention to detail. There's only the best of materials that are being used. And that also comes down to the components as well. You know, it's not just the type of woods that are being used. It's also like the bridges and the fret wire and stuff like that. The tuning machines. You know, actual ESPs are kind of going for broke as far as making sure you get a quality instrument. E2s, a little bit of a step down, maybe in terms of the overall quality of wood. I feel like the finish work is still exceptional. I feel like the overall QC and final setup is still exceptional. Not to the same exacting standard as an ESP, but the E2 line is pretty goddamn close and really, really, really well built. I have yet to find an E2 that's got a blemish on it that hasn't been marked as such. As far as the LTD line goes, that's where you're starting to cheapen in materials and in components a little bit more. It's definitely a much more mass-produced setting, and as a result, sometimes things just aren't gone over with as fine tooth of a comb as the really nice stuff. Is it still an exceptional instrument and still well worth playing? Yes. In my honest opinion, ESP is one of the most consistent in terms of quality control across their entire line. Actual ESPs are fucking phenomenal. E2s, kind of right up there with them almost. There's just a little bit of a difference in terms of playability and attention to detail. LTDs, there's a little bit bigger of a gap in terms of difference between the LTDs and the E2s, but still very exceptional, still very well worth the money, in my opinion. You look like you lost weight, dude. Hey, thanks, man. I've actually been doing keto since mid-August, and it's working out phenomenally for me. So far, I'm really, really, really close to 25 pounds. I've kind of hit a little bit of plateau and I'm kind of experimenting with my diet a little bit to see if I can get over the hurdle. man, I just really want to break 200, and I keep hovering right around 202. It's killing me. But I actually have lost almost 25 pounds, so thank you for noticing. Oh, damn, haven't seen the glasses since iFAQ number 12. Nice. Here's a question. Did you see the new Dime Slime Solar E and V models? If so, what are your thoughts? I think they look fucking phenomenal, and I think it's no secret that Ola is a huge Dimebag fan, probably one of the biggest in the world, to be honest with you. Certainly one of the most well-known. In my opinion, him kind of appropriating that finish, so to speak, is only paying tribute to one of his heroes. So I see absolutely zero problem with it whatsoever. It's just that, yeah, because Ola is a huge Dimebag fan, everyone's gonna associate it with that. I say more power to him. They look fucking incredible. Knowing what I know about Solar guitars, they're probably gonna sound and play fucking incredible too. So yeah, that's what I've got to say on it. What happened for your orange Aristides 070? Is it for sale? I'd buy it. Ooh, where were you a couple years ago when I sold it? In all honesty, I did sell it already. It was one of those things where at the time I was really not playing seven strings at all. And as awesome as that guitar is, it kind of got to a point where it was like, why do I own this? I have an instrument I spend X amount of dollars on. It's not a cheap instrument, not the most expensive I've ever owned by any stretch, but it's not a cheap instrument at all. And I'm not really playing it. And it had nothing to do with the build quality or my desire to play it. As far as the instrument goes, I wasn't gelling with seven strings so much back then. And to this day, I kind of still only have one seven string in my possession. I've got my Reaver and I love playing that one. But back then, I pretty much only played sixes and eights, like at all. So I made a decision. I was like, you know what? Why am I hanging on to this Aristides that I'm not even playing? Why don't I instead turn around, sell this thing, and actually put the money towards one that I'm gonna play a lot, which is my 080S that I have behind me. I actually play that one far more on the regular. It's super inspiring to me. I love the tone that comes out of it. I love how fucking rock solid of an instrument it is. It's also a goddamn inspiring instrument to play on. It just feels good. So yeah, I end up writing a lot on that instrument. I end up picking it up at a lot more. So it was like, okay, get rid of this Aristides so I can get a different Aristides. Wow, living in Texas, that state brought forth a lot of famous guitarists. Dimebag Darrell, Eric Johnson, Billy Gibbons, Stevie Ray Vaughan, just to name a few. You're surrounded by some exceptional talent, living or dead. You know, spirits never fade. But isn't Texas also a very conservative religious state? Is it easy to be a metalhead and not be condemned almost? Lots of love and respect from the Netherlands, man. Keep this channel alive. It's awesome. Okay, so yes, Texas is kind of historically and, you know, kind of reputationally a red state. It is very conservative. It is very Jesus-y. Like, to quote Lewis Black a little bit, Jesus Christ is big here. Like, he's like the Coca-Cola of Texas. He's everywhere. And like, kind of everywhere you go, oh, there's another church, there's another church, there's another fucking mega church. Fuck those evangelicals, by the way. But like, everywhere you go, there's another church popping up. And you kind of go into all these places and you always hear, have a blessed day, have a blessed day, which I don't take offense to. I just understand that what they're really meaning is have a great day, have a nice day. So I take it as such. But yeah, there are definitely pockets here or there. Texas is a massive state and there's tons of places to live in Texas. Kind of a weird joke that I hear a lot in Texas is that a lot of times people are having to reference where they live versus like the next major city. Like, oh, I live 100 miles to the east of El Paso. Oh, I live 100 miles north of Houston. Or I live, etc. You get the point. And in those kind of small town areas, you come into a lot of rural people, who don't necessarily kind of operate on the same wavelength as people that are in urban settings. You know, I'm not saying if it's for better or for worse, but I'm just saying that a lot of times the viewpoints are differing. And, you know, because of that, this is a very, very conservative state. Yes. Now, do I get persecuted because I'm a metalhead? No. When we moved out here, I was definitely concerned about that a little bit because of the state's reputation. But instantaneously, I noticed that, oh my God, there's tons of people here that love metal. Fuck, every time I go to the grocery store, every time I go to the Walmart down the street or the HEB or something like that, it seems like I keep running into dudes wearing Amon Amarth and Testament shirts. Like, every single time. It's not just like the super mainstream stuff like Metallica, Faithfuck, or Death Punch. It's like I go in and there's someone wearing a Vitriol shirt. And he sees me wearing a Vitriol shirt. And it's like, brother! Brother! You know? It's a little bit of that going on. It's kind of cool. I would say that there's enough of us here that if someone was getting fucked with or picked on, I'd like to think that we would have each other's back. So that's probably the best answer I can give to that. So, but yeah, I love living here. Hey Arnold, have you ever considered opening your own brewery? Doesn't matter if just a home brewing machine or a boutique brewing company. As a fellow guitar player and beer aficionado, I want to hear your thoughts on that idea. Don't get me wrong, the thought of starting my own business has crossed my mind. Whether it be like an actual brewery, or whether it be even a guitar company or something. Here's why I don't do it. Because I am in the business of reviewing guitars and amps. I'm in the business of reviewing beers on this channel too. I would not want every single thing that I do to come under such intense scrutiny. Because a lot of people would jump on the fact that, oh, he started doing this? Well, it sucks. Let me tell you why. Ha ha, the motherfucker who keeps talking shit about this brand or that brand can't do it himself. And it's because of that that I just like, you know what? I'm not even gonna deal with that shit. I'm just gonna let the professionals who've been doing it for most of their lives do it for real. And I'm just going to enjoy it. Hello, Arnold. I ordered a custom single humbucker guitar with no tone knob. Was I an idiot for trashing the tone knob? Not at all. I'm definitely in the minority opinion that I like having a tone knob because I like being able to, in that sort of instance where I feel like maybe I'm tracking a take and it's coming off a little bright, rather than fuck with some awesome amp settings that I've figured out, maybe I can just roll back the tone knob ever so slightly just to kind of like dampen that harshness ever so slightly. So I like having a tone knob. That said, I definitely understand that there's a tonal difference the more pieces are put in play in the signal chain. So getting rid of the tone knob, just having a single volume, you know, does have an effect on that. It tends to get you a little bit more pure tone coming out of your instrument. You know, removing all the pots and switches does the same thing. I definitely like having a tone knob, but at the same time, I played a ton of killer guitars that have not had one, and I don't think it's necessarily 100% required, to be honest with you. And now it's time for this week's
Troll of the Week.
And this week's Troll of the Week, this guy's funny. He kind of creeps up into my comments section about, I don't know, once every like maybe 4 to 6 months. And I block him every single time. He must just love picking on me for whatever reason, because I'll block him, he'll create a new username and just start posting shit again. So, here we go. Hello, midget. What's up? Your guess is as good as mine. You know, I don't know why he's got to use a derogatory term like that, but yeah, I'm 5'8", so I don't know why he would even go to that, but it's funny. Like, this is one of my repeat offenders that just keeps coming back and keeps coming back, and I know it's him because he always uses the same term. It's so fucking stupid. What a sad life you live that this is your only release, this is your only happiness, is just to be a dick in a comment section. So with that, thank you guys so much. Another iFAQ video has come and gone. I appreciate you guys so, so very much. Like this video, subscribe to this channel, find me all over Instagram, Facebook, and all over other forms of social media, Arnold Plays Guitar. And remember, take what you do seriously, but do not take yourself too seriously.